Let's open up our Bibles to Acts chapter 28. We're on the last chapter of Acts. This has been an incredible series of looking at what in the heck happened in the new church. And wow, the way this book closes just completely blows me away. What we've been learning in the last chapter, really the last two times we've gotten together, we've learned how to live life in crisis when it happens. Amen? Yeah. So today, we're still on the subject matter of crisis. And the title of today's message, Acts chapter 28, verses we're going to look at 1 through 10, is called Finding God's Favor on Mission When We're in Crisis. So last week, we left off with Paul managing a crisis where he literally found himself shipwrecked. If that ain't a crisis, I don't know what is. And Paul saw how being energized with the fruit of the Spirit not only brought him through the storm, which it did, but it gave him the ability to bless 265 men that were on that boat in the middle of a crisis. And you remember what happened as we looked at this last week. And instead of being fear-controlled, Paul was self-controlled. He was drawing on God's love instead of self-preservation. And his thankful spirit spread to everybody on the boat. And his faith, it overcame fear to such a point that he was able to lead in a situation where he was supposed to be the prisoner and a nobody. Amen? Amen. Listen, when God shows you favor, it doesn't matter what the world thinks you are or who you are. When God's favor happens to you, you rise up in the middle of the crisis. So now what we're starting to see in this last chapter of Acts is there's literally a golden thread of opportunity in the Christian life when you're walking in the Spirit. When you've surrendered your life to Christ, and you're actually experiencing God's power. And what happens is you begin to experience God's power wherever you go, whatever you're doing, even in the middle of a crisis. And it doesn't mean you're not going to encounter problems. You might be in a shipwreck right now. It's right where God wants you. It's right where He's going to show you His favor. All you got to do is surrender and give him a chance to power up your life. So you might be going through some heavy stuff, but even though you may be facing impossible circumstances this morning, if you will look to God, He's going to show you His favor. And please, I don't want you to take my word for this. Let's take a look at the Word of God ourselves this morning and just see what He has to say. But what I'm trying to say is this is really important, and the question we want to ask this morning is, how can we find God's favor in a crisis? First of all, we're going to find it with non-believers. That sounds pretty crazy, doesn't it? Now, when I tell you you're going to experience God's favor, you probably don't think about experiencing it through non-Christians. But as we open up in verse 1, we know these guys are shipwrecked. We know they made it to shore. And it says, when they had been brought safely through, then we found out that the island was called Malta. And the people on this island were of Phoenician descent. And not that that means much to you, but the Phoenicians had become famous for their commerce and world-class sailing. So this wasn't some illiterate island they found themselves on. And they also became famous for the production of glass. And verse 2 says, the natives showed us extraordinarily kindness. Now when it says natives, it's not talking about illiterate islanders. It's referring to the people that were locals on that island. Like we would say, native Californians, not natives in a hut, native to their island. But the incredible thing was these non-believers were showing the love of God to strangers. So God was using non-believers to show his favor to the men that had been shipwrecked on the island. So what I'm trying to say this morning is we can't be surprised when it happens to us. When God uses non-Christians in your life to bless you. I remember once I had been involved with far-reaching ministries, and we were making a trip to Russia where we visited Russian youth prisons, and I had to raise my support. And it was about $3,300 to go to Russia for about 3 weeks and then come home. And the thing that blew me away, I was raising support from a lot of people, but my very biggest donor gave what was equivalent to about $1,800 was a non-Christian. And I was working for a pharmaceutical company at the time, and my regional manager was a believer, and she sent me a $200 check, which I thought was pretty neat coming from the regional manager of a company. But then her husband, who I met on an island that we were all at with a sales award that we did, he found out that I was going, so he paid for my whole airfare. A non-believer. And I just go, that was the first time I ever experienced God's favor from a non-believer. But now I'm open-minded. I'm not... I don't say anything's impossible to God. It's like whatever God wants to do, that's what I want to be into. Other things happen. I know in my life one of the most significant things that happened with non-believers blessing me as a believer is when I was working for that pharmaceutical company. We were a British company that got bought out by a German company. And so the first thing they did was fired half the sales force because they wanted their new sales force to be in charge. And so, you know, I'm sweating a few bullets and praying, just going, okay, God, whatever's going to happen here. So, I make a long story short, they kept me. You know, I kept my job. And I just thought, wow, that is like way cool. Thank you, Lord. You use this way out there German drug company to protect me. That's awesome. And so I was talking to my wife, and we were having our own little celebration together, just watching what God had done. And then we said, you know what we need to do? We need to increase our giving. And, you know, we thought about that a little bit. Well, my position is still a little iffy. We just got taken over by this company, and, you know, you could still lose your job. You know how Satan likes to plant in your mind to be fearful so that you won't do what God wants you to do. We said, forget it. We're going to up our giving. So we upped our giving, and 3 weeks later, I get a call from my manager. They go, you know, since this new drug company took over, this German company, they did some statistics, and they found out that British company that we worked for was way underpaying their employees. So my boss calls me after we decided to give more and said, you know, you're getting a $1,200 a month raise, but not to worry because you're still going to get your annual raise. I go, wow. I call my wife and told her, and she goes, $1,200. She goes, you misunderstood. It was $120. I go, no, it wasn't. It was $1,200, man. Non-Christians, God's blessing, showing favor. Man, we don't know what's going to happen. It's just God doing what he wants to do. And in our passage this morning, God was using a group of non-believers to minister to Paul and these other men that were shipwrecked. Verse 2 goes on, it says, for because of the rain that had set in and because of the cold, they kindled a fire and received us all. So look, rather than capturing these folks that were stranded on a shipwreck and making slaves out of them, God showed them favor. And last Sunday, we saw that Paul was showing kindness and the love of God to the men on that ship. And that's all it took for God to show his favor to Paul. And this is what was interesting. We were talking about this last week. When God shows his favor, many, many times the people that are with us get the favor too. Just like my wife being with me when I got my raise. You know what I'm talking about? It's like in this situation, Paul was getting God's favor, but there was 260 men that received it too. We're talking about grace, undeserved favor. And what I'm trying to say, you guys, it isn't. an unusual circumstance. This is actually a promise from the Word of God. And if you have your Bible, go ahead and open it to Proverbs 3:3. How many people have memorized Proverbs 3, 5, and 6? Anybody? All right, there's some hands out there. But nobody memorizes Proverbs 3:3. Well, Proverbs 3:3 and 4, I think, is more exciting than 5 and 6, which I like too. But listen to this. It's an incredible promise. It says, do not let kindness and truth leave you. So kindness and truth, it's really important. Bind them around your neck. In other words, do something, get them in your life, tie them around your neck so you don't lose them. And then he says, write them on the tablet of your heart. How are you going to do that? By memorizing it. That's how you write it on the tablet of your heart. So here's a couple of verses to memorize. It's going to be so good for you. Why? So you will find favor and good repute in the sight of God and man. Well, now you go back to the shipwreck, before it was shipwrecked, and you see Paul showing kindness and love to the men, and then God showing his favor to Paul when they get shipwrecked. Not one person was lost, and everything is being answered for them. So how do we find God's favor in a crisis? First, we can find it with non-believers. Second, we find it through God's protection. When we're walking in the Spirit, I don't think that we should be surprised when God literally intervenes with his protection for us. Verse 3 says, when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and laid them on the fire, a viper came out because of the heat and fastened itself on his hand. I think even Paul got one heck of a surprise here when he got snake bit. And it's interesting to me that Paul didn't sit around when he got saved on that island. Like, you know, he was the one that pulled everything together, not the ship captain, not the centurion. It was amazing. It was Paul. So if anybody could have kicked back when he got on the island, it was Paul. He was the one that was doing everything. But he didn't. He's a servant. He's servant of all. He's out gathering wood. He doesn't think that somebody else should do it. He's the one doing the forging. He grabbed a pile of sticks, but when he got close to the fire and threw it to the fire, one of those sticks was a snake, and it just bit him. And it said when the natives saw the creature in verse 4 hanging from his hand, they began saying to one another, undoubtedly this man's a murderer, and though he's been saved from the sea, justice has not allowed him to live. However, he shook the creature off into the fire and suffered no harm. So this time, God intervened miraculously, and he literally saved Paul's life. And I think that this should tell us something. We should expect the miraculous when it comes to God intervening for our protection. It wasn't just for Paul. That's what I'm trying to say. That intervention of God's favor is for us, not just Paul. It's for us right now. I know I've had this happen in my own life. I was in Sudan about 7 or 8 years ago in Africa, and we have a compound there, and we have about 8 guards at our compound that are armed with AK-47s, and they keep the peace there. And our guards are not necessarily Christians. Our chaplains are, which we train to go out in the field and minister to soldiers. But one of the guards that we had on duty that night, about 7 o'clock, got bit by a black mamba. Now, a black mamba is such a poisonous snake, they call it a 6-step snake. You walk about 6 steps and die. That's how poisonous it is. And somebody came and got me and another one of the local pastors there in Sudan, and they brought us out to the front gate where this guard was. Well, he'd been bit about 15 minutes ago. That's a long time. And he'd been bitten by a black mamba, and he'd already thrown up about 5 times on the ground. So, dude, he was poisoned. And we knew he was going to die really quick. There was absolutely nothing we could do. No doctor. You know, there was a field hospital about 2 miles away. And we did have a truck, but one of our chaplains had taken the key out of it and walked to town. So we didn't have any way to get him to that field hospital. So I went out with another one of our local pastors, and we looked at the guy laying on the ground, and I just said to John, the pastor, Pastor Okuma, I go, we need to lay hands on him and pray for him, because if we don't, he's going to die. And I tell you, I was shaken to the core, because we had about 15 chaplains standing around looking at us. And, you know, I'm a teacher, and so I'm going to go, I'm thinking, this is what Satan's planting in my mind. Man, don't pray for him in front of the men, because you're going to pray for him, he's going to die. And what are they going to think? So that's rumbling around in my mind. And I just told John, I go, John, we have to pray for him right now. So we laid hands on him, and we prayed for him, and at least he didn't kick the bucket right there. You know, he stayed alive, and come to find out, there we had a neighbor that was about two compounds down that did have a vehicle, brought the vehicle over, threw him in the vehicle, got him down to that field hospital in about 2 minutes flat. The doctor was there. The doctor said, the only thing that's going to save him is Black Mamba anti-venom. And he goes, we haven't had any in 6 or 7 months, but some Swedish missionaries flew in yesterday and left us 12 vials. And he got 11 of the vials and left. That was God intervening. See, you know, I just figured, well, look, if God's going to intervene, he's just going to heal the guy on the spot. He didn't do that. Look, you can't tell God what to do. He's going to do it in his own way. I could care less whether God wants to fly in Swedish missionaries and give them the anti. Who cares how it's done, you know? Because the glory goes to God. All I know is that experience was every bit as real as Paul's experience of getting bit by whatever bit him by that fire. Then watch the reaction in verse 6. It says, but they were expecting that he was going to swell up or suddenly fall down dead. But after they had waited a long time and had seen nothing unusual happen to him, they changed their minds and began to say that he was a god. Wow. Now, even though we know that that was the wrong response, and Paul would never take credit for what God had accomplished, but Paul saw God's favor again with a supernatural intervention. So how can we find God's favor in a crisis? We find it through non-believers, believe it or not. We find it through God's protection right in the middle of the crisis. And we find it with people in government. Now, that's pretty weird. You find favor with people in the government? Wow. Verse 7 says, now in the neighborhood of that place were lands belonging to the leading man of the island named Publius. Okay, Publius was the Roman governor of Malta. So when God opens the door of his favor, it goes all the way to political leaders, and nothing will be held back from us who are willing to answer God's calling. See, that's what this is all about, being on mission wherever God has you. You don't need to go on a missions trip. See, I'm not talking about that. Being on mission is being ready to do God's will right where you're at. And that's what God's looking for. It's incredible enough that the governor of this island was entertaining 265 men that were shipwrecked. But verse 7 says that he welcomed us and entertained us courteously for 3 days. So when you're shipwrecked in God's favor, you don't go in a cave and look for food and water. You stay in the governor's mansion and you get entertained for 3 days. That's crazy, isn't it? Wow. One of my dear friends that started this ministry in Sudan is Wes Bentley. And I have watched him experience God's favor like nobody I've ever seen before. And one of the things that God has done for Wes has lived by faith and gone out there in a war situation where nobody else wanted to go to the suffering church and started a ministry of chaplains in that army of 450,000 soldiers. And because he stepped out on faith, he's seen God's favor like I've never seen anybody get before. Not only have thousands of, among thousands of soldiers received Christ, but the top military brass in that army have become believers, including the Joint Chief of Staff that has been discipled by Wes over the past 12 years. And Wes was also the best man at his wedding. You know, Wes has so much favor with the Joint Chiefs of Staff in Sudan that when you go to Juba, which is their capital, that's where their military and political headquarters is. That's where Commander Momul is, who is the Joint Chief. When Wes comes to visit Momul, you find the American State Department waiting in the room to see Momul. And when Wes walks in, Momul invites Wes in, and not the upper brass of the Americans. And they go, "Who is that guy?" And he goes, and Momul heard him, "Who is that guy?" And he said, "This is my best friend. I will talk to you later." Man, that's God's favor. You know, we find God's favor even in leadership and political realms, because God is the director of all leaders. The Bible says that He moves leaders' hearts just like water to the left or to the right, and His favor is coming forth in the middle of that. So we got to remember that we're seeing this favor happen here in a crisis, and that's our subject matter this morning. How do we experience God's favor in a crisis? We find it in non-believers. We find it in God's protection. We even find it in the people in government, and we find it through the ministry of prayer. Verse 8, it says, "And it happened that the father of Publius, the governor, was lying in bed afflicted with recurrent fever and dysentery." Now, one of the things I love about the Apostle Paul is he's never intimidated by anyone or any situation, because many times Satan will try and intimidate us from ministering to someone who's important or somebody who's really up there in a leadership position, especially in prayer, thinking, "Oh man, if God doesn't answer our prayer, we're going to look like fools to this leader." And there's no telling how many miraculous events or blessings from prayer that we have missed out on, all because we got intimidated by the enemy. He wants to block God's blessing from us. Listen to me this morning, please. You don't have to be anybody special to pray for someone and ask for God's healing. He'll take anybody's prayer. You don't need permission from anybody. Look, you guys don't need my permission. You got carte blanche with the Lord. You just go, and then you watch what He's going to do through you. You don't need a handkerchief from a TV preacher, you know, to get your prayer answered. You just need to believe the Word of God, and then you just need to step out on faith and do it. Are you ready? I got one amen. What about the rest of you guys? Are you ready? Amen. We got a little more.
Amen.
Are you ready?
Amen.
Oh, thank God. Now we're going to do something in Wildemar. I can hardly wait, man. You know what, you guys? This is so cool because Jesus tells us how to do it. You know, I don't want to try and figure this out. It's all too complicated for me. It's way above my pay grade to try and figure out who I should go to, what I should say, when I should do it, and on and on and on. So Jesus makes it so much easier so we don't even have to figure it out. Like when He was speaking in Mark 11, 24, He says, "Therefore I say to you, all things for which you pray and ask," listen to this, "believe that you've already received it, and it'll be granted to you." So, hold on a second. This is a whole new way of thinking. Instead of being in the begging mode, because that's what we do, "Please, God, please, God, please, God, like today, man, expedite it now." We don't have to beg anymore. And we also don't have to ask God over and over. We just begin to pray as if it's already happened. So, you know, as I was going over this yesterday, I happened to be going by our church property. It's on Grand Avenue over by Clinton Keith. It's right by Bear Creek. And we have three acres over there, and we have it for sale. And the Lord touched my heart. Drive up to the top of the property. It's a hill. So I drove up there, and I got to tell you guys, I'm so guilty of begging. So many times I've been on top of that property going, Lord, today's the day. Come on, man, you know, I'm ready. And yesterday I went up there and I just went, I'm going to keep my mouth shut. And I'm going to apply this verse to my life. I know you've already sold it. I know that you've already hooked up somebody's heart to fall in love with this property. I fell in love with it. I'd give anything to buy the property myself and build a house on it. It's got a 360-degree view. It's just gorgeous, man. And the Lord began to minister to me as I began to thank Him for having sold the property already. And I just, so what I'm trying to tell you is I'm applying this stuff to my life. I'm not just preaching it this morning. I'm changing my life. I'm changing my view so that God can change me so that He can move. So Matthew 7:7, Jesus speaks again and says, ask and it'll be given to you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and it'll be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and he who seeks finds, and to him who knocks, it'll be open. Now what I love about this, it's not hard to figure out. You know, I can be a little slow and a little pig-headed. That's why I love the Word of God. And my favorite book in the whole Bible is Proverbs. It's easy to read, easy to figure out. If we'll just apply it to our life, we'll be the most successful people in town. And finally, James 5:16 tells us how to do it. He says, therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for one another so that you may be healed. Hey, so many times, you guys, you know what's blocking our healing according to James? We're in sin. And it's, so it's like we have our fingers crossed and behind our back as we pray. You know, I'm not getting out of sin, but please do this for me. You know, David said in the Old Testament, if I hide iniquity in my heart, He's not going to answer my prayer. So we just need to get right with the Lord. That's kind of what we're talking about here. And if we want to see God's favor, if we want to see the answers to prayer that He's promising us, we need to be transparent with each other. It doesn't mean that we need to share all our dirty laundry with each other. It's really not talking about that. But it's being transparent enough with each other to go, man, I'm struggling. You know, this area has been dogging me. And I really need you to pray for me. Man, that's awesome. You start having people pray for each other like that with real problems, you're going to see revival break out. And James goes on, he says, the effective prayer of a righteous man can accomplish much. And so he gives us an illustration that's absolutely perfect for Southern California. He says, Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly or fervently that it would not rain. All right, which one of you guys have been praying for drought? Because it's here, man. It didn't rain for 3.5 years. But it says, then he prayed again, and the sky poured rain, and the earth produced its fruit. I believe that this verse has a direct application to all of us that live right here in Southern California. We are in the worst drought in Riverside County's history. Ever since Riverside County began to record rain, which was back in the 1800s. We've never been in a drought this bad. I don't know if you guys know it or not, our groundwater is down to 12%. And when it's gone, we're gone. So this is worth praying for. I really believe that God is challenging us this morning in the Word to pray for our state, California, that God would send us wonderful flooding rains this winter through the Spirit of God, that the Spirit of God would move the whole earth around if He has to bring incredible storm tracks to Southern California. You know, when you begin to see God's favor from prayer, sometimes when you pray by faith and you pray like it's already happened, then he shows you something. Well, that's what he did with us already. Because I know a lot of us have been praying for rain, and we've also been fasting, and he's already given us a sign that he's going to do it. It's called El Nino. Now, last year we had an El Nino situation. It's where the water gets warm off the coast. But it was only like a 50% El Nino, and that doesn't do much. But right now, we have a 98% El Nino. And what all the prognosticators are saying, that this is going to be one heavy, wet winter, because that warm water is going to pull storms in from the Gulf of Alaska and the Gulf of Baja, and between the two of them, we're going to fill all our reservoirs. See, God even gives us a sign when we begin to pray. When we begin to pray like it's already been done, then he's going, okay, I like that kind of faith. Take this. Here's an El Nino for you. Wow. So we've declared Tuesdays at Calvary Chapel Bear Creek to be a day of prayer and fasting. I don't mean this Tuesday. I mean every Tuesday. And what we're praying for is not just rain. That's almost a side issue. What we're praying for is revival. That, yeah, we have the water come back to refresh the earth, but we have the Holy Spirit come back to Southern California so that we can have a refreshing revival. And then we're praying that God uses us, not somebody else. I mean, we pray everybody gets involved, but what about us? We're the ones. So we've declared Tuesday to be a day of prayer and fasting. We actually meet for prayer here at 9 a.m. And we're praying that God changes everything. Mostly, we are praying for revival and the opportunity to take the gospel right here in the Temecula Valley. So Paul prayed, and he found God's favor when he stepped out on faith. The latter part of verse 8 says, and Paul went in to see him, that's Publius's father, the governor's father, and after he prayed, he laid his hands on him, and he healed him. So how do we find God's favor in a crisis? By finding it in non-believers, place we wouldn't look. By finding it through God's protection, he's always got his eyes on us. By finding it with people in government, all the way to the top, like the Joint Chiefs of Staff. By finding it through the ministry of prayer. And by finding it through revival. Just stay with me here and look what's going on in this passage. Now, this is what happens when people begin to experience God's favor through prayer. People get a new understanding of who God is. You know what, you guys? Most people have a warped view of God. And if you don't believe me, I dare you to go to one of the malls and just take a little survey for yourself. Go out there and start asking some questions like, who do you think God is? Or what do you think God is like? You're going to be blown away at what you get. Because most people have a warped view of God. They think that he's some distant, unloving, uncaring, and always angry God. They have no idea that God loves them and is just waiting to show them great and mighty things. They don't have a clue about that. And when people find out God's real, they start coming out of the woodwork. And that's what happened to Jesus. And that's what happened to both Peter and Paul in the book of Acts. And that's what happens here in this passage. Look at verse 9. After he healed Publius's dad, it says, after this had happened, the rest of the people on the island who had diseases were coming to him and getting cured. The whole island was showing up to see God. That's what we're praying for, is that the whole Temecula Valley will show up because God's present in this church. Amen. People want to see God. They're just not really very interested in us. Amen?
Amen.
Wow. All right. How do we find God's favor in a crisis? We find it in non-believers. We find it in God's protection. We'll find it in the government. We'll find it in the ministry of prayer. We'll find it in revival that comes from the prayer, and we're going to find it because when all this happens, God's going to meet all our needs. maybe not all of our wants, but he's going to meet all of our needs. Look at verse 10. It says, this is talking about the island community. They also honored us with many marks of respect, and when we were setting sail, they supplied us with all we needed. Wow. The Apostle Paul and everybody on his boat had been an awesome witness on that island. From the time the islanders took care of them and made them a fire and fed them and took them to the governor's mansion and celebrated for 3 days, people were not only healed, if I know Paul, many of those people on that island got saved. And remember, you guys, Paul wasn't on a missions trip, was he? No, he's going to Rome. He was in Caesarea at that trial that was a mock trial, and he's on the way to Rome to see Caesar. But he wasn't on a missions trip, but he was on mission. Yeah, this is cool. Because wherever he goes, wherever he is, he's on mission, so he doesn't miss out on God's best. Somebody that's on a mission trip may share the gospel or reach out to the homeless or orphans while they're on their missions trip and come home and never do it again till next year. So what good is a missions trip? Man, it's like man's way to do things, isn't it? And I love missions trips, but what I try to tell people, I'm just as excited to get back to Wildomar from Africa as I am to go from Wildomar to Africa. Because I know when I get home, I'm going to be sharing the gospel here too. And I'm going to be discipling people here too. I'm just doing the same thing in Sudan that I'm doing here. Because I'm on mission. We can't act like we're going to go on a missions trip. That's really not what God's looking for. God's looking for someone, anyone, who's going to take his call seriously and be on call 24/7. We're like an emergency care doctor. And so the phone is by our ear 24/7. And when the Spirit of God whispers in our ear and says, now, we got to share it. And Larry, I'm going to pick on you this morning. Could you come up here, man? I usually don't do this, but this morning I really want to pick on Larry, man. Give him a hand, will you guys? Anybody that's brave enough to come up here, man. Larry, I want to tell you, I want you to tell them what happened when you were four-wheeling last week and you ended up mentioning church to somebody, right? Or something like that?
I belong to a four-wheel drive organization, and once a year we have an annual event. We had 425 four-wheel drives sign up and over 1,000 people attend. I led one of the trails.
And you guys, these trails have boulders this big that we go over.
Anyway, camp next to us, we rent Snow Valley Lodge. We have that whole parking lot. But one of the rigs across from us, this guy has the same type of vehicle that I have, and he come over and struck up a conversation, and we talked for a little bit. But come to find out, on Saturday, he was on my trail. So part of the trails, we go down in this valley and come up into a big plateau, and that's where we had lunch. And we're sitting there talking and stuff. Him and his wife come over, and he told me that he lives for this. He lives for this four-wheeling. This is his passion. And then he just looked at me like I'm supposed to respond. So I looked at him, and I said, well, I live for Jesus, and I get to do this too. And they looked back at me like, didn't say nothing, and you know, that's fine. And we finished our lunch and we went on the trail and stuff. Well, the next morning, I'm loading up my four-wheel drive and he comes over and starts talking to you. He says, thank you for what you said yesterday. It hit home and I'm really glad you said it.
Wow.
And it was just like, I didn't intend anything. Like you said, I was on a mission. It just came out. Mm-hmm. And it hit somewhere at home to where I think he's going to go back and be a little bit closer to God. Amen. And that's what I'm thankful for. Yeah.
Amen. Thanks, Larry. Now you know what I mean by being on mission. He didn't have to share a certain track. The Holy Spirit, I believe, whispered in his ear in a microsecond, and he just said it. It was pretty brave, I think. Pretty courageous. And you know that guy couldn't stop thinking about it because he came to you the next day and thanked you for saying it. Sometimes these things from the Holy Spirit can be so powerful. See, it's having a sensitivity to the Holy Spirit to move at any time, and we answer the call. So being on mission is awesome because, you know what, you don't have to have a Bible degree. Amen? You don't have to be authorized by a mission board. You don't have to wear a collar. You don't even have to go to a confessional. You just got to be filled with the Spirit and be willing to move when God says go. And you know what, you guys? This is the way God likes to do things. When he sent his disciples out, he told them not to take any money. Well, that's scary. You know, go without any money? What are you talking about? And he said, I want you to trust me that I'll supply all your needs through the local people. And they're probably thinking, well, you know, I trust you, Jesus. I'm kind of so-so with the people. but then he also said, look, don't even worry about it. If they don't support you, just blow the dust off your feet because somebody else is. So don't worry about it. Just go. And it's kind of God's philosophy. So let's remember Paul and all these soldiers and sailors and prisoners, they have absolutely nothing. Now, for those of you that missed out on last week, when this ship got shipwrecked, before they hit the rocks, they threw everything overboard. They threw most everything overboard about a week before the shipwreck itself. They threw the ship's tackle overboard. They had no way to maneuver the boat. They're just being blown around. And they threw everything off that boat in the middle of the storm. But because Paul was on mission, they didn't have to spend a penny when they hit the island. See what I mean? It's just crazy. They were warmed. They were fed. And they were taken care of in the governor's mansion. See what I mean? God's first class. I don't mean to say that you guys should gather all your money together and buy me a new jet. No, see, I'm not talking about that. That's testing God. But what I'm talking about is God is so sufficient. He goes beyond being sufficient. Finally, when a ship did come to that island to rescue them, it says that all their needs were supplied. No wonder Jesus in Matthew 6:31 says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and all these things will be added to you. So you might be sitting there thinking, you know, I really like this, but like, when is it going to happen to me? I can tell you, it's going to happen to you when you release your life to Jesus and you humble yourself and you're willing to step out on faith and be on mission. Amen. 24/7. When we're allowing the Holy Spirit to move anytime He wants and when we're on mission, look out, devil, because he's so going to lose. You know, he can whisper as many things as he wants, as many intimidating factors as he wants into our ear. But we're on mission. When we're on mission, we're looking at God's sovereignty over the entire universe. What an encouragement to your calling. You don't even have to work it out. God's going to work it out through you. And people are going to see God through us, and they're going to show up on our front doorstep. Because they keep seeing God in us. It's like Larry. The guy saw God in Larry. That's why he came to the next day and said, whoa, thanks. And what did Larry say? He didn't preach the whole gospel or read the whole gospel of John to him. All he said was, oh, really? I'm excited about God and I get to do this too. And the guy just went, whoa. He's like, what the heck was that?
The gospel of Larry.
You know, one of the things I love about people on mission is they're people that like to have fun. You know, a lot of times we as Christians walk around like we were weaned on a stinking dill pickle or something, just a sourpuss. I mean, some Christians are so bummed out. You know how your lower lip can hang out when you're depressed? Some people's lower lips are so low it looks like they could suck marbles out of a gopher hole. And they're supposed to be Christians, you know? I know that this life gets hard, but the best witness that we can be is when we're going through a crisis to explain God's sovereignty to somebody. And just say, man, I haven't been in a situation this bad in my entire life, but for some reason, I got a peace that God's going to get me through it. People want to hear that because they're not getting the peace and they're hardly getting through it. The whole world's in a crisis right now. Just watch TV, watch the 5 o'clock news, and the crisis keeps getting worse. So our lights are shining brighter and brighter, but let's don't be a bad witness of talking about how terrible it is. Everybody knows how terrible it is already. They need some hope, and they need some truth in their ears that God is real and He's taking care of business right here on earth, even though it's in a crisis. So people are going to see God through us. And they're going to want to know God too. So how can we find God in a crisis? We find it in non-believers of all things. And we find it in God's protection right in the middle of the crisis. Classic example is when those Jews walked through the Red Sea right in the middle of a crisis by finding it with people in government, like the Pharaoh that honored Joseph and made him the leader to do everything in that land. We find it through the ministry of prayer, and we find it through revival as a result of prayer, and we find it as a result of having all our needs met. Let's pray. Father, I pray in Jesus' name this morning, Lord, that the Spirit of God would go past me, Lord. Father, I pray that your word that was mentioned this morning would become a powerful tool, Lord, a wedge that would come into our hearts this morning right now. Lord, I believe that there's many things surrounding our hearts that are keeping you from penetrating to the center. It's our worries. It's a lack of faith, Lord. And I'm not pointing the finger at anybody this morning except myself. Sometimes the worry and the lack of faith blocks your power. So what we're asking you this morning, Lord, would you help our unbelief this morning? Would you accept us where we're at? Lord, you said if we have the faith of a mustard seed, you'll move a mountain for us. And I know we got a mustard seed from everybody here. Thank you. Thank you for not making it complicated so we could just do it, Lord. We don't have to go to school anymore, Lord. We don't have to perform for you. By your almighty grace, you're flat out going to give it to us, Lord. And it's called your favor right in the middle of a crisis, Lord. So, Lord, what we want to do, and I'm going to ask you to pray with me right now, if this is your heart. And pray out loud, because I believe God wants to hear us. If you're ready to surrender, to be on mission this morning, this is what I'm talking about. If you're ready to experience God's favor, then pray with me these words. Dear Jesus, thank you for loving me. Sometimes I don't like myself. Sometimes I can't believe you like me. But you love me. So I want to surrender myself to you this morning. Take me, God. Put me on mission. Forgive me of everything, Lord. Give me a fresh filling of your Holy Spirit. Give me the power that I don't have to be courageous for you, to speak your word, and to share the gospel, and to love this world that's in crisis. In Jesus' name, amen.